Proverb talks about bless the man who brings, bless the feet who bring good news. And so, Brad, this morning we ask blessing upon you as you've if you've studied, and I believe this man has a word for our church, word for each one of us here today. And so, would you guys stand with me? Put your hands together as we welcome Brad Mayer.
Hallelujah. He's speaking one of my favorite verses right there. Well, you can be seated. God bless you. And God bless this church. I'm sorry that Pastor Terry is not here. He's one of my heroes of the kingdom. I just love your pastor so much. But I love this church, too. I even love everything just from, like, you know, there's little things that you notice. And just, I go from place to place and church to church. But I just thought, you know, as we just released these kids, I was down with some of the leaders before the service, praying before the service. And the thing that caught my eye was a world map in the children's room. And I just thought, and it wasn't where, you know, you put a world map up high. It was for the kids. It was down low. And I thought, praise God, these guys are my kind of people, you know, because I'm a world missions guy. If you have not met me before, my name is Brad Mayer. I'm on staff at City Center Church, sort of. The last couple of years, I've been shifting into a missions calling that has been designed by the Father for my life since I got into full-time ministry. I got a photo with myself and Reese here because we've known each other probably 30 years. And so he was in Saskatoon many years ago when we were both in university. He's studying pharmacy and me studying business of all things. And so I have a business degree, but shortly after that, I went into ministry and come to this season of my life where I leave the comfy church salary behind and step into the missions world. And God has just been awesome, blessing us wherever we go. So I want to share a message with you that I call Involving Man in the Miracle. And so hopefully this makes some sense to you. My prayer, as always, when I come and hit the pulpit, I never know what a church is going through. I don't know what's going on in your lives. And so I've never shared this anywhere before. And so I'm just trusting God that his strength is made perfect in my weakness, that the things that he's put inside my heart would be a blessing to you and cause you to go out and impact Assiniboia, impact your world. Amen? Amen? Let's look in the Word of God. Mark chapter 8, verse 1 to 9. I have this from the New American Standard. It says, in those days again, there was a great multitude and they had nothing to eat. You know, I just want to stop there before I go any further. Do you know, as an evangelist, I got to say this. There's people out in the world, great multitudes with nothing. You just stop in the inside of that little verse. I was just studying the verse again this morning, just as I was having breakfast, and I saw that little part of that verse, a great multitude with nothing. And around the world, you'll just see that over and over and over. And you don't have to go to a foreign land to find great multitudes with nothing. You know, sometimes you go see a huge concert at whatever it's called now, Credit Union Center, Sass Place Center in Saskatoon, and they'll get 15,000 people. And you'll see a great multitude with nothing. There might be some people with some gifts and some talents and some abilities, but as far as the things of God, it's just like, you have all this stuff, but you have nothing. Well, Jesus had these people, they had nothing to eat. And so it says, he called his disciples and he said to them, I feel compassion for the multitude because they've remained with me now three days, and they have nothing to eat. If I send them away hungry to their home, they'll faint on the way, and some of them have come from a distance. His disciples answered him. It says, where will anyone be able to find enough to satisfy these men with bread here in a desolate place? And he was asking them, well, how many loaves do you have? And they said, seven. And he directed the multitude to sit down on the ground, and taking the seven loaves, he gave thanks and broke them. And this is the verse I wanted to key up on here today, is verse 6. He started giving them to his disciples to serve to them, and then they served them to the multitudes. They also had a few small fish. And after he had blessed them, he ordered these to be served as well. They ate and were satisfied. They picked up seven large baskets full of what was left over of the broken pieces. About 4,000 were there, and he sent them away. So, you know, Jesus, this is a regular day for him. He's God in the flesh. He worked miracles all the time. Miracles are the norm for him. He healed the sick. He raised the dead. He cleansed the lepers. He cast out demons. But he didn't want to be alone in any of those types of miracles. He wants us to be involved in the miraculous. He calls us also to be involved in the supernatural. He didn't want to be the only guy doing this. And so Jesus, and if you read through the scriptures, he regularly invited man into the miraculous. He regularly made a point of just saying, you know, I don't want to be all alone in doing this. I want you guys to be able to understand miraculous power and how you also can and should be doing miracles in your life. You believe this? And so he wants that miraculous power to be displayed for the world. You know, I look out into the world and I see the world longing for the reality of God. They just want God to be real. I just came back from Romania, and this is my third time there. The last time I was there, I ended up preaching to a bunch of gypsy kids. And as I preached to them, my heart broke because these kids are just empty. The Orthodox religion of that country, and don't mean to badmouth anybody, but that religion, not so much the people. I love people. I don't care what religion they're from. But sometimes the systems and the structures and the religions of this world just leave people shallow and empty. And I'd look into the eyes of these kids, and I'm just thinking, this system has done absolutely nothing for them. They've got the body, they've got the spirit, but they're empty inside. And so this is why we need to go. And this is why we need to show the world the reality of a supernatural, miraculous God. Because when people see miracles, then they believe. When people see miracles, then they respond. And so this world's looking for the reality of God. And showing the world signs and wonders, it's one way. It's not the only way. Sometimes people need to be shown the love of God. Sometimes they need to be shown the truth of God. Sometimes they need to be shown the miracles of God. Today I'm talking about the miracles of God. And so, you know, it shouldn't just be God alone doing the miracles, but that the people of God work with him and do those miracles with him. How many of you are willing participants that you say, you know what, God, use me. I'd like to see some miracles. I'd like to see some supernatural things. You know, I prayed for a guy one time. I think I may have shared this story before. I never know where I've shared my stories, but it's a true story. I prayed for a guy with a crooked eye. You heard this before? This guy, he's got two eyes, and one is crooked. So he was serving time in jail, and he got punched in the head in a fight in the Sask Federal Pen in Prince Albert. And he got punched in the head, and his eye was crooked. So you go to look him in the eye, and he has one eye looking straight, and he has one eye looking over here. So you don't really know which eye to look in if you want to look him in the eye. And I wasn't even talking to him about healing. I was talking to him about Jesus. On 20th Street, in front of a store called Boomtown Outfitters. If you know 20th Street, it would be about 20th Street between Avenue B, C, D, somewhere there on one of the letter streets, in between some of the letter streets. And as I'm telling him about how he needed Jesus in his life, how he needed to be saved, how he needed to be rescued from sin, God straightened out his crooked eye. Right in front of my face. And I'm talking to him. I found out his name. His name was Scott. And I said, hey, Scott, God just straightened out your crooked eye. And he turned and he looked at his reflection in the store window that was behind us. This was night. It was a street outreach. And he turned and he looked. And I'll never forget it. He jumped back about a foot. He's like, whoa! And then I had a First Nations brother with me who was sharing Christ. And he went and decided to do the big evangelist thing. He said, now cover your good eye. And so he covers his good eye. How many fingers do you see? How many fingers? And he did this. This guy wasn't just crooked eye. He was blind in that eye. And God restored a blind eye in 20th Street in Saskatoon just a few years ago. This guy got completely healed without anybody saying, you know, blind eye, be opened. But just the love of Jesus Christ who wants to involve us in the miraculous. Amen? His heart is motivated to involve man in the miraculous. See, these hungry crowds, they follow Jesus into the wilderness. And Jesus could have performed a miracle and he could have fed them all by himself. But that's not how Jesus wanted to operate. He wanted to bring man into the mix here. He wanted to have us involved in the miraculous. He started this miracle of feeding the 4,000 with something that they had. They had 7 loaves of bread. Something they thought was so insignificant compared to the crowd and how big it was. Apparently, they only counted the men. So 4,000 men, this is the custom of the day. And each of them, you know, today, what do we have in Canada? 2.2 children or something like that. But there, it was probably 8.6 or something. In that day, I don't know how many. So who knows how many thousands could have been there. And 7 loaves of bread seems so insignificant compared to the size of a large, hungry crowd. And so, you know, you think about how Jesus did miracles. He could have used dust from the ground and make bread for the multitude, but he didn't. You know, he used something that the disciples produced. And he longs to always do that. He longs to take our small seeds, our small offerings, our small talents and abilities, whatever we might have, and he wants to show the world how he can make something of our seeming nothing. But not nothing. Because if we don't offer him anything, then he has nothing to multiply. And so we offer him something. We offer him what we have. No matter how insignificant we might think our offering is, God can then do something with what we have. Well, let me look at two of those middle verses there that I just read from out of a new Bible that I'm reading right now called the Common English Bible. It's not the, yeah, whatever, I won't say what I think of it. But flip ahead to the next one there. Common English Bible, Mark 8, verse 6 and 7. It says, he told the crowd to sit on the ground. He took the 7 loaves. I want you to see a little bit of a progression here. He gave thanks. He broke them apart. He gave them to the disciples to distribute, and they gave the bread to the crowd. And then they also had a few fish. He said a blessing over them, gave them to the disciples to hand out also. So Jesus involved his disciples in the miracle. He could have had them all form a single line and say, I am Jesus, the miracle worker. Everybody get in single line and come and get your free bread and fish from me. But no, see, that would have been massively time-consuming. And Jesus wasn't some egotistical person. You know, there's that verse that says he shares his glory with no other, that he won't share his glory with another. I heard somebody say one time, though, that we're not another. We're his. And so it's not like we're looking for his glory, but you know what? He's getting the glory. I can't do miracles like that. So it's obvious he's getting the glory, and he longs to involve his children with his supernatural power. He longs to do this. And so, you know, he knew that for a crowd of this size to be fed, he had to utilize the men of God that were with him. And he knows that if his gospel is going to impact the world, that he has to utilize the men and women of God, just like you. He has to utilize you in Assiniboia and all the little villages and towns and cities that are right around here. He has to use you if he's going to see the loaves and the fish be multiplied here in this area. And we wait on him to do it all by himself. You know what? It's not going to have the same impact, because God's design from the Word of God is that he uses people and that he uses us. He works with us. So he gave the multiplied bread and fish to the disciples to distribute, and it was the disciples who gave the bread and the fish to the crowd. Wouldn't that have been a cool assignment to have? You handed a little basket of fish, you start giving it out. And it just ain't running out. And you just keep giving it out, and the hungry mouths keep coming, and it just doesn't run out. You know what? I think we've had that miracle at City Center Church in Saskatoon. I'm convinced we have. Because we opened the doors. We're going to do it here in the first part of October. We do it Thanksgiving, Christmas, and Easter. We throw a sign out front. We create little business card size invites, and we just say, Thanksgiving dinner. Now come. And so some of you know my wife. She's in charge of the kitchen there. And so if you're a caterer, this would be a nightmare for you. Because caterers always want to know, like, how many people are coming to the wedding. And then they get mad at you if you're, like, 4 people off or something, you know. And so you say 132, and you had 136, and they're just like, oh, okay, we have to pay for those extra 4. And you know what we have to do for that meal? We plan for a certain amount, give or take 200. Or 300, for that matter. Like, literally. We literally have done that. We say, well, shoot for 600, give or take. It could be 900, it could be 300. And we've had days where, oh, man, why did we do this on check day? You know, nobody cares about your free food on check day. And so we figured out that a long time ago. We don't do that anymore. But so you're 200 less than what you thought. And you have all these extras, all these leftovers. That's okay. We'll find people to eat that food. But there's times where we had 300 more than what we thought. And I'm thinking, God, how's this going to happen? And we've never run out of turkey. We've done it with ham. We've done it with buffalo, bison. And we've never run out of the main course. And I think it's been multiplied. I don't know how you prove that, but I think it's, you know, this kind. Why not? You know, Jesus said, heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers. Those kind of miracles can happen today. Why couldn't we have some multiplication of turkey? You know, there's no direct Bible equivalent, but, you know, that's what we use. So he gave those multiplied bread and fishes to the disciples, and they got to be the guys who gave it to the crowd. And so they're the ones who directly, you know, are face to face with the crowd. You know, they had the firsthand part in manifesting this miracle. And the miracle doesn't originate with them. Don't get your you know, shorts all tied up in a knot or anything, you know, because some people think, it's like what the sister said here this morning about the greatness of God and how he wants the greatness of God to be alive and at work on the inside of us. He does. And it's not so that people will bow down and start writing praise and worship songs to us. No, it's about God. It's about God, that the excellence of God might be on the inside of us. The whole world will know it's God. And so the miracle didn't start with them, but it was carried through their hands to those who would receive it. And so that's so much how God desires the miraculous to be carried on in our day. He really does. Jesus once said this, John 14, verse 12. He says, "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he'll do also. And greater works than these he will do because I go to my Father." I know you've heard that verse before. But Jesus talked about the greater works. And he wants us to do the greater works. I don't even think there are Christians. There are hardly any Christians who can wrap their brain around this. Can you? I'll just be honest. I'm just a human being. I have a hard time wrapping my mind around this. Because it just seems almost so sacrilegious. It seems almost so far out there. Like, Jesus, you fed the multitudes. You raised Lazarus from the dead. You walked on water. And then you said, "I want you to do greater stuff." They say, "How?" Now, is it greater in quantity, greater in quality? What is it? It's definitely greater in quantity. Why? Because there was one Jesus. There's a billion of us that follow him in one way, shape, or form throughout planet Earth. And certainly in quantity, we could do greater works. Amen? You think about a billion people who believed in signs, wonders, and miracles. And I know many of those billion don't necessarily flow in that respect of Christianity. But just think, even if the 30 or 40 or 50 of you here today, you know, can believe in signs and wonders and miracles and the supernatural God at work, just in the everyday affairs of life. Wow, wow, wow. Jesus spoke of believers doing the works he did, and he spoke of us doing even greater works than he did because he went to be with the Father. And then he specifically gave his followers instructions to do greater things, to do impossible things, things that were beyond their ability to do without some sort of supernatural provision, supernatural strength from him. We can't do what he's called us to do. You know, I quoted it already today, but I have it up here on the PowerPoint here. Matthew 10, I think it is, verse 7 and 8. Is that it? Did I get the right? Yeah. Matthew 10, verse 8, where he just tells us. This is like, heal the sick, raise the dead, or cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely receive, freely give. How many sick people do you have here today? You could be, but, nobody looks deathly ill here today. Let me ask the easier questions. How many lepers here today? No lepers. Okay, how many dead people here today? No dead people. How many demons here today? Or demon-possessed people, let's say it that way. Any demon-possessed? Okay, freely you've received, freely give. The fact that you don't have leprosy means you can go cleanse a leper. The fact that you aren't dead means that you can raise the dead. The fact that you aren't demon-possessed means you can cast out some demons out of someone. And the way Jesus just says this, it's like those of you, the brother in the front row here, Josh, he was telling me that you got lots of little kids, but not so many of the teenager age. I've had teenagers, mine are all in their 20s now. And you know how you could give your teenagers a to-do list of stuff that they could do? Or maybe you could do that with your littler kids, just all fit, you know, with what fits with their age. But if it was something like pick up your toys, clean your room, you know, don't fight with your brother. Don't punch your sister, you know, whatever. And it's like just a little to-do list. Look at Jesus' to-do list that he gave us. They're all impossible. He told us to do all these things that just like a mom might tell her kid, hey, clean up your room, wash the dishes, you know, pick up your clothes. And Jesus just tells us, go do these things. Jesus, we can't do these things. We can do these things because Jesus is not a crazy man. So he's not giving us this little list of things to do with the idea in the back of his head, they won't be able to do it. He's fully convinced we can do this. He wouldn't have told us if he didn't think we could. So heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Man is clearly called by God to be involved in the miraculous. If we go through life without God's supernatural touch being a part of what we do and how we impact others, that's a shortfall of what we were created to be. How many of you have ever learned the Romans Road? Do any of you know the Romans Road? It's a soul-winning kind of set of passages of scriptures that people use. And one of the most common verses that is used as people kind of list different verses to give to the unsaved to lead them to Christ, one of the most famous verses is Romans 3 and verse 23, where it says, "For all have sinned and..." We all know about the all have sinned part, but did you ever notice the last half of that verse? Because just like you know that it's not the will of God for you to live in sin, it is also not the will of God for you to come short of the glory of God. It's not right that we would go through life coming short or falling short of the glory of God. I said, what does that mean? I don't know. What does it mean? What is the glory of God? I love the Old Testament word is kabod, which means the weighty presence of the Lord. We're not to go through life without the weighty presence of the Lord being a part of our life. If we go through life without the glory of God being a part of our life, it's like going through your life with sin. The two are listed right in the same verse that it says all have sinned and everybody falls short of the glory of God. Just like it's not God's will for us to sin, it's not God's will for us to fall short of the glory of God. And see, when miracles happen, she's already put it up there, when miracles happen, God is glorified. God gets glory. People stop and take notice and wow, you know, God is real. And we're to be the carriers. We're to be the carriers of the glory of God. You know, when the multitudes were fed that day, the people realized, they said, a miraculous event just took place. They knew the disciples couldn't do this. They knew Peter and James and John and Bartholomew and those guys. They didn't have the power to do this. They knew Jesus was behind the supernatural multiplication. They knew that, and God is glorified because of this. God is glorified because of this supernatural miracle. Man was allowed to be a part of it. Man wasn't necessarily to get the glory for it, but to share the glory or kind of be a part, I guess, you know, a carrier of the glory in a sense. And that way, I think you're not falling short of the glory of God. Amen? Shouldn't this be the way our daily lives go about? That the glory of the Lord is part of it. And again, we can't originate the supernatural. We can't make it happen by ourselves. We got to be connected to God to see the miracles happen. But we're to be walking with God. We're to be taking his supernatural power to a waiting world. We offer what we have to him. And sometimes it ain't much. Sometimes it's just like a few loaves. 7 loaves and a few small fish. And so our offering compared to the need or compared to the bigness of what, you know, what kind of miracle is necessary in this situation. And what we have to offer is so small compared to the need for the miracle, which might be so big. I just love that. He takes what we offer and he multiplies it. He takes something that we offer. It might just be a tiny little seed and he multiplies it. And he does something so far beyond our boundaries that the world has to stop and take notice and say, whoa, how'd you do that? How'd you know that? You ever have a word of knowledge for someone? It just messes with their head. Where you know someone's inside of their heart. And you start to speak. I was speaking in Romania a couple of weeks ago. And you know, I literally pray this before I hit the pulpit almost every time. I pray what I sort of said just at the start of this message today. I say, God, your strength is made perfect in my weakness. And sometimes I'll come up with a message and I'll hate the message. I'll just say, that message is stupid, God. Like, it's just a message that's dumb. You know, I don't like that message. I don't want to preach that message. And God will argue with me and he'll say, I gave you that message. And I don't want to preach that message. I want to preach a better message. I got this other one that was, you know, I hit it out of that park that one time. God, you want me to preach that one? And I don't want you to preach that one. I want you to preach the one I gave you. And I argue with God. But after almost 30 years of ministry, I figured out to, you know, how to hear the voice of God. Just preach what he says. So I preached this message here in Romania just two or three Sundays ago. And I preached this message that I called Untitled. Good name for a good title for a message, Untitled. And the idea of the message was we come to God untitled. If you come to God thinking that you're so hot, you just probably shot yourself in the foot and you just kind of ruined the whole thing. And, you know, you got all these important guys like Pontius Pilate and the high priest and whatever. They all had their titles. If you read the first part of Luke's gospel, it'll give a long listing of, you know, all these tetrarchs and these governors and the Caiaphas, the high priest. And then the Bible says, the word of the Lord came to John, the guy without a title. The guy that's walking around in, camel suit and eating grasshoppers in the wilderness. And God's word comes to him. It doesn't come to any of those bigwigs with their titles. It comes to the guy with no title. And so we come before him untitled instead of entitled. And then we get retitled. That was the message. So I'm preaching a message inside a message. So this is the crazy part of this message, though. I'm talking about my weakness and just thinking, why does that fit for this church in Romania? Well, I use the verse that says, don't think that being sons of Abraham is going to count anything special for you. And so I use this. Now, here's the crazy part about it. I didn't know that there was some crazy power trips going on in this church and that all the kids of the pastor were thinking they could just do whatever they want. And I didn't even put two and two together. I just preached the message thinking I'm blessing the people. And I find out later, and I knew the pastor I'd preached in his church before. His name was Avram, which in Romanian is Abraham. And I preached this message about this, and this one guy in the back says, you don't know how accurate of a word that was. He said, you have no idea. And all his kids were sitting right here in the second row. And I preached this, don't think that being sons of Abraham gives you any special privilege. And I'm saying, and those guys are squirming a little bit. And I don't know what I'm saying. And they come to me afterwards and they say, did you know that Avram is Abraham? I thought, no, I didn't know that. And so God does stuff like that all the time, that in our weakness, and sometimes in our complete ignorance, God does supernatural things. And I think if we knew, I'm going to nail them between the eyes with this. No, see, then, when we don't know, when we just have this little, here's some of my loaves and my fishes, and it's not much. And you know that it wasn't you, it was God. That's when it's powerful, amen? I want you to notice something about this story. I want you to notice that Jesus wasn't insecure with his glory. He wasn't concerned that some of it might spill over onto somebody else. He knew, of course it could go to somebody's head, but he was very willing to bring his disciples into the miracle. And he wasn't insecure with his glory. He wasn't all about, now I am Jesus, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And you guys better back off, in case some of the glory might just spill over on any of you guys. No. He wanted his disciples to experience the glory. It's like what our sister said today. He wants us to experience his greatness. He wants us to walk around and carry the glory of God on the inside of us. Again, not so that people bow down before us. What do we want people to see? Christ in me, the hope of glory. Not me, but Christ in me, the hope of glory. You know, it's funny, as a minister around the world, I've asked people sometimes to introduce me as internationally unknown evangelist. Because I think about it, I've been to 38 nations, but I haven't been to 220. I don't know how many nations are in the world, but there's over 200 I haven't been to. And so, sometimes they'll get your name wrong, or they'll one time they spelled my name on this poster, B-R-A-B. So I'm Brab. In this place, Brab. One place, they did, one country, an entire country. They didn't even know my last name. And so every time I'd get introduced, it was all the way from Canada, Evangelist Brad. Praise God. I thought, I'm kind of like one of those famous soccer players, he's only got one name. And then there's other times they get the name wrong, the information wrong. Who cares if they get it wrong about me? Because it's not about me, it's about him. And so I don't care if you get it all wrong about me and you completely forget everything that I said. If you remember that I preached about Jesus today and that his presence is here, then that's what it's all about. Amen? And so, I think about how Jesus, he was so willing to bring his disciples into the miracle. They're the ones that brought the miracle to the people. He was the creator of the miracle, but guess what they were? They're the face of the miracle. You ever thought of yourself like that? They're the hands and the feet of the miracle. They were the hands and the feet of the miracle. They were the distribution program for God's supernatural power. And it hasn't changed. We're still the face of the miracle for the world. We're still the hands and the feet of the supernatural. For God to touch the world in a supernatural way, he does it through us. And he chose to do it through us. We're the distribution program for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I love the way Mr. Bonnke says it, he said it this way before, is that God uses manpower, but man needs God's power. I love it. I should say it with a German accent, it'll sound more powerful. Like Reinhard Bonnke, God uses man's power, but man needs God's power. I love Mr. Bonnke. I've met him. I know he's been here. I saw the pictures in the pastor's office. He jumped on on some farm equipment here a few years back. That's awesome. See, without man, that miracle that day of feeding the multitudes, it would have been so much more limited in its scope. It just would have been. And it's not because Jesus is weaker. It's just because Jesus is smart. And he chose to be willing to use those who walked with him. And let his miraculous power impact so many more lives than he would have been able to impact on his own. And it's not so much that he needs us. It's that he wants us. It's not so much that he needs us. He's God. He doesn't necessarily need us, but he wants us to be involved. He wants us to be working with him. He's God. He could have fed the multitudes with dew raining down from heaven and having it turn into manna. What is it? I think that's one of the funniest parts of the Bible, that it's actually there, that they called food that they ate. What is it? For 40 years. And actually for the rest of history. Because that word manna means what is it? So every day, what you doing? Eh, I'm going to go out to collect the what is it. That's what they call it. That's what they still call it. And so he could have done it that way. He could have had somebody go up and strike a rock, you know. He had Moses do that and water came out of a rock. See, God could have fed the multitudes a gazillion different ways because he's God, but his preferred way to do it was to involve man in the miraculous. Amen? Is this stirring something up inside your heart? See, in the new covenant, you know, the example set before us is a God who walked among humanity in a body of flesh and blood. He's a God who worked with imperfect people to show a broken world a supernatural, miracle-working God. Okay, this is a perfect example of my broken offering that I'm giving to God here today, because I think I have on this PowerPoint 3 steps, but actually it's probably about 5. But I thought, I'll come to Assiniboia and I'll finish this PowerPoint. And I got working on this message, and I had computer problems. And so just scratch out the word 3, just say steps, because I don't know how many there will be. But there's at least 3. I'll get, and that's as far as the PowerPoint goes, and I couldn't fix it. So it fits. It fits with this message, because it's like our insignificant or our insufficiencies, our not so much, our I don't have it all together, and we offer that to God, and then God does something with it. Amen. Yeah. This is who he is. We think sometimes, oh man, I got to be perfect. I got to be the best preacher. I got to be the best singer. I got to have it all together. I got to have a ton of money. I got to have this, that. We think we got to have, but you know what? God used their little few fragments of bread to feed a multitude. He's God, and he's looking for something coming from us. Amen? So I want you to notice a few steps. I say 3, but let's probably end up at about 5 before we're done. So first of all, he used what was given to him. So he used what was given to him. He didn't just, you know, whoosh, out of thin air, just like, woo, here's your pizza, you know, and just, you know, invent some food out of nothing. But he says, what do you guys have? They go, well, we just, you know, they're probably a little bit ashamed. Big, huge crowd. There's 7 loaves of bread, Jesus. That's all we got. You know, and he probably a little bit embarrassing. But he asked the people what they had. And this is one of the ways, it's always really been his way to involve man in his miracles. Let me look at it from another gospel, from Matthew's gospel. Matthew 14, verse 15 and 16. Out of the New King James, I'll read this. It says, when it's evening, his disciples came to him saying, this is a deserted place and the hour's already late. Send the multitudes away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food. I love this. Look at the difference between the heart of Jesus and the heart of his followers at this point. The heart of his followers, get rid of them. Send them away. You know, we can't feed these guys, so tell them to go home. Tell them to go to the 7-Eleven. You know, tell them to get out of here. And Jesus, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. I like it in another translation, just even short and more to the point. He just simply says, you feed them. Why would Jesus say that? He would say, hey, you feed them. Ah, just kidding. I know you can't. No, he didn't do that. It's very much in his heart that they would be involved in this miracle. He told them, you give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. And they couldn't wrap their brain around that. This is like that greater works. You'll do greater works verse. This is the same kind of thing. You feed them. Does not compute. You know, computer failure. They couldn't imagine how the tiny little bit of food they had could make a difference for so many. They just couldn't figure this out. But the words of Jesus are clear. They did not need to go away. You give them something to eat. He just asked them to do, he just asked them for something because he wanted to do something with what they had. Something's going to require a supernatural power, but it also requires their willingness to work with him. And when you give something that's yours, you're invested into it. You know, when I go do conferences, sometimes we'll do pastors and leaders conferences. I was just in Uganda and Rwanda here back in May. And we had, I think, 500 pastors and leaders. And I was with some spiritual giants. I was just like sitting there curling up in my chair thinking, God, how did you bring me to this place? So I sit in this room with 15 leaders and they start to go around the circle. The first guy goes and says, well, I am Pastor so-and-so and I have planted 40 churches. Then they go to the next guy. I am Pastor so-and-so and I have planted 75 churches. Then they go to this one guy, 78-year-old guy, like just an older fella. And he goes and he says, I am Bishop so-and-so. I have planted 350 churches. And I'm thinking, I'm Brad. I have planted zero churches. You know, I'm an evangelist from Canada who preaches on the street corner. How am I here? And I'm feeling like a worm, you know, amongst these spiritual, you know, giants. And these hundreds of leaders in this room. But you know what's cool about these conferences? You put these conferences on in a lower income nation, and we always ask that the pastors pay something. We could come in from North America and we could pay for everything, but then they're not invested. And so if it's like a couple hundred pesos or a couple hundred shillings or whatever the money is in whatever country, and that they pay a little bit, something that's slightly painful for them, but maybe might be pocket change for you and me. And it's important. It's an important principle because, you know, here in this case, God say, 7 loaves of bread. It might have been all that they had. Like, we'll give away our 7 loaves of bread, man. We're going to starve. My kid won't eat tonight. But they gave what they had. They gave what they had. And Jesus says, you give them something to eat. Jesus didn't want to do the miracle alone without their involvement. And so the miracle of multiplication, it started with something to multiply. How many of you remember the math class? Where you learned that anything times zero equals zero. Well, say you just have something. And you think, oh, I don't have very much. Man, all I got is something really, really small. Like, it's not even a whole talent of ability. You know, I can play the guitar, but I only know, like, 2 chords or something. So say you start out with something that in your brain it's like 0.0001. That's all you got to offer God. God, I give you my 0.0001. But guess what? 0.0001 times 2 equals 0.0002, which is twice as much as what you started with. But if you just offer God and say, God, here's my zero, you're stuck with zero the next week because you never gave him anything to multiply. And so he's not going to, you know, go and defy his own principles of how things work in the universe. And so, you know, you see this over and over and over throughout the scriptures. Jesus is the great multiplier, but we have to provide the material for multiplication. God uses what we have, even when it doesn't seem like much. And certainly not the only place in the Word of God where this happens. You remember the story of the woman that's in debt and she goes to Elisha? And she goes to Elisha, and she says she's got a big problem. And Elisha, the first thing he says to her, he says, what do you have in the house? She says, and then the way she answers, it's so telling. It's the way we are. Human nature is human nature. From 3,000 years ago to today, it's still the same. She answers when he says, what do you have in the house? She goes and she says, your servant has nothing except for a jar of oil. And isn't that the way we are? Instead of focusing on the something that we have, which is the jar of oil, and it may not be much, we will focus on the nothing. And so she states that she has nothing before she actually tells the truth that she really does have something. You remember the story? Takes that jar of oil, it starts to pour it out, and she's told, go collect containers from everybody. Don't gather just a few. go bring me another container. And here, there's another message inside a message, is that there are empty containers all around in Assiniboia that are waiting for somebody to pour the life of God into them. I was so tempted, not tempted, good tempted. I had breakfast just over here at 121 here this morning, and there was a guy who used the F word about 75 times in about a 10-minute space of time. And then he also used Jesus as if he was a swear word. And I was just torn because I thought, I wanted to just go sit across from him and say, the guy that you use as a swear word, he's real and he's alive and he died and shed blood on a cross so you could be forgiven. Stop using his name like it's a foul term. So maybe I'll see him before I leave Assiniboia. And so she said she has nothing. How about Moses? Same thing. Moses was scared to lead the children of Israel. Do you remember the story? I think it's about Exodus chapter 4, somewhere in there. And he's scared to lead the children of Israel. He doesn't think that the people are going to follow his leadership. God goes and asks him, what's in your hand? What's in your hand? Elisha asked the woman, what's in your house? Ask the man of God, what's in your hand? He had a rod. He said, throw it on the ground. He throws it on the ground. Turns into a snake. He goes, grab it by the tail. Turns back into a rod. All of a sudden now, people are going to believe you. But what does it take? Something in his hand, something in her house, something in your life. What do you guys have? They have something in their crowd out on the hillside that day where people are starving. You know, the heart of Jesus is not that they leave and go back home, but that they stay with him. And he says, you give them something to eat. Well, what's the next thing Jesus did? I'm watching the clock there. I'm guessing you guys probably usually stop around 12. Is that all right?
No.
No? Are you serious? All right. Okay. Because that was just the introduction. No, I'm just kidding. What's the next thing that happened? Next thing that happened is Jesus gave thanks for what was offered to him. We're coming up to Thanksgiving, beginning of next month here. And it was just 7 loaves and a few fish. But Jesus actually gave thanks for it. It's like he turned to the Father and he's like, thank you for these 7 loaves and 2 fish. Or whatever it is, 3 fish. And Jesus is thankful. He's grateful. I think he's grateful for a couple of things. He's not just grateful for the food these guys gave up. He's grateful for some disciples who are willing to sacrifice what they had to be able to, you know, really work together with him and see a massive miracle. And that's about to take place here. And they don't know that. Maybe they do because he'd already fed the 5,000. But the first time it happened, they didn't know. If 5 loaves, 2 fish, what are you going to do with them, Jesus? Give a crumb to everybody? You know, a fish scale? You know, here's your fish. Divvy it up into 4,000. How's this going to work? Because in our natural minds, it doesn't work. And then this whole idea of him giving thanks for something we offered to him, isn't it backwards to us? Because usually we're the ones giving thanks for something he gives to us. And he flips it on them. And he says, you know what? He's given thanks for something we gave to him. Jesus has given thanks for something people did for him. He's looking for that. He's looking for people who would offer something that they have to him, no matter how small we might think it is, because he can do something with your offering of whatever he gives him. And I'm not just talking about money. I'm not talking about money. It could be a simple talent or an ability or something that you are custom designed. I'm preaching in jail one time, and I was preaching about God's purpose for your life, God's plan for your life, and that God's plan for your life, telling the guys in jail, I'm telling them, he didn't create you to sit in jail. He created you with some gifts and abilities, and you're good. I had a guy sitting in the front row. He jumps to his feet, and he goes, and he says, I'm called to be a welder. And I went, and I just high-fived the guy. I just said, good. I said, you have passion about that. Get out of jail and go be a welder. And if you have to learn some skills about welding while you're in jail, then use it to your advantage. But I love to see the passion in the guy's heart because he had a gift. He knew he was good at what he was good at something. And this is what I'm talking about when I say offering something, some loaves and some fish to God. It's our offering to him. And yet, come back to this thought about thankfulness from Jesus. What might you have in your life that would cause him to give thanks if you were to offer that to him for the sake of his kingdom? What? Could you make Jesus thankful today? You know, we're all about, Jesus, make me thankful. You know, give me a new car, give me some more money. And then I'll say, thank you, Jesus. But what if it was, thank you, Bernie? You know, what if it was, thank you, Josh? You know, and Jesus saying these words back to us, thank you. You know, this is what he's looking for. And you know what? We all want those times and seasons of blessings in our lives when we give thanks to God. But don't you think that Jesus himself also longs for those times and seasons where he can give thanks for something? A willing servant giving what they have. You know, it could be somebody who's downstairs right now working with the kids. And they're giving what they have. And maybe if they tried to come up here and stand in the pulpit, it might be a big challenge to them, but they're awesome with kids. I know people like that. That can't say five words behind a pulpit in front of adults. I'm the opposite. I have trouble with kids. I remember I preached to a children's church class one time, and I just did it the way I thought I knew how to do it. And I told them, hey, kids, turn in your Bible to John chapter 10. Well, I might as well have thrown the service out the window. Because 15 minutes later, you know, the kids are crying, like, where's my Bible? And you know, like, you, Billy, ripped the page out of my Bible. And where did you say again, preacher? You know, and so, yeah, and next time I'll just tell you John chapter 10. I won't tell you to turn in that page. But see, God makes us different with different gifts, different talents, different abilities. What do you have to offer up to him? Man, I'm looking at some of these ladies here in this church. Man, I bet you some of you are pretty good at baking cookies. I'm not hinting. I don't need any cookies. I probably need less cookies, but I'm just saying. Maybe somebody out here in Assiniboia needs your cookies. And you could be used by God with something that you're good at doing. And so, you know, and then what happens in that situation? Jesus gives thanks. He says, thank you. Thank you, sister. You know, I think of Reese, you know. He's a drug dealer is what he is. He probably hates when people say that. But I work on 20th Street, so in my language, where I'm from. But he probably knows. You don't mix this medicine with that medicine. You don't do this in your training, and probably your gifting is probably mixed together. Am I right to say that? And so, you know, if he sees somebody who needs this kind of medication that would make their life better, wow, this is a gift from God. This is not just, you know, a guy who went to school to get a job. And so God uses these different things, you know, that we have. So a simple gift, a talent, a smile, a kind word, a few hours of help for a friend in need. What might your offering be? What might you be able to give that would cause your Savior to give thanks for what was offered? You know, this last school year, I guess it's two school years away now because we're just starting a new one. We had a young lady from Ontario living in my wife and I's home while she went to Bible school in Saskatoon. And this girl, her name was Serenity, but she was the most cheerful person I think I've ever met in my life. You would never find Serenity not smiling. Never. And now I taught in that Bible school that she went to. It wasn't the one at City Center, it was another one. And I taught in that Bible school, and I taught a class on evangelism. And I had a question on the test, and the test was, how do you see God using you in the area of evangelism? And she put as her answer, part of her answer, I think that God would use my cheerful disposition and the smile on my face. And you know what? I gave her full marks. Because I said, you're right. You're absolutely right. God will use who you are. They say, what if I got a grumpy disposition? Can God use that? I don't know, maybe. It's coming from God. It's not coming from the devil. You know, I don't know. But see, my point is, you know, a smile, we might think, that's not much. But God takes our not much. And he can make something out of it. Let's go further here, seeing I have 2 hours left here. So I won't take that long. Third thing Jesus did was, and this is really eye-opening. I pray that God will just start to open my eyes as well as yours just as I dive into this, because this is something I'd never seen before. The third thing Jesus did was he broke the bread that was offered to him. So they came with their little tiny offering. Here's the bread and the fish. And Jesus breaks it. He breaks the bread. You think of broken bread all throughout the scriptures. It has all kinds of meanings. We get the meaning of communion. We get the idea that Jesus himself at one point said, I am the bread of life who comes down to feed the world. and that he himself becomes the broken bread that's offered up for all of humanity. That's the gospel right there, is broken bread. And he goes, and Jesus does this with this minuscule little offering. Here's seven loaves of bread. Did you know they collected up seven baskets afterwards? Start out with seven loaves, end up with seven baskets. Sounds like God to me. So broken bread or breaking bread has many meanings throughout the scriptures. We can see it as a picture of communion, a remembrance of a body broken for us. We see it as a picture of Jesus. What does it mean? What does it mean for our offering to be broken? What does it mean for our offering to be broken? I'm not talking about, you know, you throw $5 in the offering plate and then Pastor Terry comes and tears your $5 bill into little pieces. That wouldn't make a lot of sense. But what about your offering? Some of these more, less tangible types of offerings. A smile, a talent, an ability, a gift in your life. You think of that story about how one guy had 5 talents, he turned those 5 into 10. Another guy had 2, he turned those 2 into 4. What'd the third guy do? He what? He buried it in the ground. Interesting picture, isn't it? So what do you do when you're dead? You put yourself in the ground. See, this guy treated the talent and the ability that God put on the inside of him. And I think sometimes people do that. They carry their gifts and their abilities to their graves. And they never give them to God. And they'll never allow God to do something with them. I may have shared this story before, maybe at a prairie fire, but I'm preaching in Colombia here a couple of years ago, a year and a half ago. I wish it was about 1 year ago, it was last September. So about a year ago right now. And I'm preaching, and it's something along these lines, I can't remember what it was about, but I was asking and I was calling out for what are the gifts in your life? And a lady in the far corner is a really big, widespread out kind of church where people are almost all around you. And in the back, way over in the far left of my left, was this lady. And I said, and I had this word, and it was so weird, and I just didn't want to say it, but the word was puppets. And this lady raises her hand up just a little halfway. And I'll never forget it to this day. I walked over to where she was in the back row. I took her hand, and when I took her hand, I almost hit the floor from the power of God that came from this woman's hand into my life as soon as I touched her. And I could not even spit out the next sentence out of my mouth. I even just think about it, I almost start to cry. I just said, "You have an anointing on your life." And tears are streaming down her face, and tears are streaming down my face, and it was all over puppets. I can't even imagine the picture. She was a school teacher, and she said, "I use puppets." I can just, my brain goes to these little Spanish-speaking Colombian puppets, you know. You know, Jesus Christ is Lord, you know. Jesucristo es Señor, you know, or something like that. Who knows? But I know the anointing of God. I know the presence of God. I know you know the presence of God. I felt a tangible presence of God in this woman's life. And it was so powerful, and it marked me. I've never felt anything like that. Ah, thank you, Jesus. Come back to this idea about a broken offering. A broken offering. Could it be that maybe he breaks apart? I think it comes two directions here. I think sometimes we think we've got something that's so good that we just come marching into things and just think, "Hey, I'm the best bass player that you've ever seen. Can I play on your worship team?" No, go sit in the service for 6 months first. You music leader? Yeah, that's a good principle, isn't it? and sometimes we need to get knocked down a few steps. But the other times, it's the opposite. We're way down here and we need to be brought up. So it's like God either takes our prideful ways or our shameful ways and he breaks us one direction or the other so that he can use what we offer. And so, you know, I think about the people that maybe think they have something that's so good or whatever, but just so that we don't ever think that we could do something and all eyes are on us, he breaks our offering to pieces so then he can multiply those broken pieces. And I'll say it this way. An offering unbroken is an offering that can't be multiplied. And I know this because I walked through this, and maybe I'll share a little bit later some of my own story. If there's time. But if we think that what we have to offer is going to make such a big difference on our own, we're sadly mistaken. We need the Savior's touch. We need our own offering broken apart by the one who'd later completely also be broken apart for us. That's the gospel. And when his hand breaks what we can come up with, we get set into the place where the world can be touched by what he can come up with. Good deal, eh? I'll say it again. When his hand breaks what we can come up with, that's when we get put in the place that the world can be touched by what he can come up with. Thank you, Jesus. What a more glorious place to be. So what's a broken offering look like? Well, it looks like these helpless dudes out in the middle of the wilderness, you know, seven loaves and a couple of fish and a massive multitude of people to try. It just looks like something so insurmountable that you think, what's the point? And that's what a broken offering looks like. A broken offering is what's needed when there's no solution on your own, when you have limited wisdom and you have no answers to be found. When, you know, how many of you have ever been there? Where the questions were way bigger than the answers. And the problems were way bigger than the solutions. You know what? That's not a terrible place to be in. It is a terrible place to be in. It always feels like a terrible place to be in. But I want you to see here today that those are places of blessing. Because God wants to do something in the midst of that place. Places of blessing, not just a place of brokenness. Because God's heart is never to leave us so broken. And so I think miracles are birthed in the midst of brokenness. Multiplication begins when our offering, our bread, is broken. And so after he breaks what is offered to him, look at, I love what Jesus does in this story. It's such a profound picture. Just draw it into your own life here today. Don't just think about multiplication of feeding the multitudes. But when he breaks it, he gives it back to them. He gives them back what they gave to him. But now it's had his touch on it. It's been broken apart. And then when it comes back from him after being broken, it's more than you started with. You offered something up to him, and you got more than you started with. You know, the guy with the one talent, he buried it in the ground. He didn't get any multiplication at all. But the guy with two got four. The guy with five got 10. Because they did something with what they had. And I believe if we put God into the equation, we get more than we started with. His act of breaking our offerings, it's what activates his ability to multiply. You think about seven loaves. What would have seven loaves done? Remove Jesus from the equation. What would seven loaves have done for that big crowd that day? Maybe seven families. Okay? Because, you know, if it's just me and my natural abilities, here's a loaf of bread for you and your family. Here's a loaf of bread for you and your family. Here's a loaf of bread for you and your family. And you got 4,950 screaming people with nothing. Because Jesus wasn't allowed to be a part of the equation. But if you bring Jesus into the picture, you bring Jesus into the picture, and you know, you don't leave him out of the equation. When his hands touch what you offer to him, he's allowed to break what we offer. That's when miracles are birthed. I heard a story one time. I think it was in Dr. Cho's church in South Korea. And they were taking up a big offering. And again, don't equate what I'm saying just with money, but this is just sort of a money-related story. And there was a pledge type of offering being taken up for a building campaign, or I don't know what it was, something big. And people were pledging. And there was big businessmen in the church, and there were people pledging, I will pledge $1 million or whatever, big amounts. And so this guy that was known to be, I don't know how to say it politically correctly, but some would say he was like, you know, mentally ill or something, you know, just wasn't all together upstairs. This is how he was known to be. He put a crazy big number on an offering pledge and handed it in. And the people, you know, would probably apt to say, oh yeah, that's so-and-so, and he's, you know, he's a bit, you know, up loony bird. But you know what this guy did? This is several years back. He went out and he bought a big bag of salt. And this is before they'd have little salt packages and pieces of, like little paper salt packages like you get in a restaurant. He bought a bag of salt, a big bag of salt, and little containers for him to put salt in little containers. Then he went to restaurants and he said, here's a portion. This is, you know, when salt and pepper shakers maybe weren't on the table. And he came up with this idea, and I guess it didn't exist in Korea at the time. And this so-called crazy guy came up with this idea. And so he'd make money. He'd sell his little packets to restaurants. And so he fulfilled his commitment. He went and he fulfilled that that pledge that he said he'd make because God provided for him, and apparently he became a very wealthy business person. And so who says that God can't do something with 5 loaves and 2 fish? You know, don't take this in a negative way, because Jesus is not a destroyer. I talk about him breaking the bread, breaking the offering. His breaking over offerings, it's not breaking something that's good in our life. It's breaking something that's limited. It's breaking something that's insufficient. It's breaking something that might not be, might well be so small and insignificant that we're kind of ashamed to present it to him. See, the disciples, I think they're probably a little bit embarrassed that all the food they had, their food program that day to take care of the multitudes that are all hanging out with Jesus, their food program was, well, all we got is these 5 loaves and a couple of small fish. See, Jesus doesn't break what we offer to destroy us. That just isn't who he is. He breaks what, you could say it this way, he breaks us to make us. You've heard make or break? He breaks to make. And so he breaks us to make us. In other words, he breaks our self-sufficiency, he breaks our fears. He breaks our too much, he breaks our not enough. He breaks our pride, he breaks our shame. You ever heard of this before? Sometimes people have pride. Don't worry, I don't need your help. I can do it on my own. That needs to be broken. But conversely, so does shame need to be broken. Oh no, I could never do that. I could never ever do that. And he breaks that. Brings us to that place where he is, where he can do something. So I say it that way. Self-sufficiency, also fear. You could say it, pride, shame. He breaks those times where, you know, we think we can maybe do it our own way. I did it my way kind of people. You know what? God can't take those kind of people because we refuse to let them. I love the end of the story, and I am coming to the end of the story. After he takes, and this could be number 4. I didn't have 4 because I ran out of PowerPoint there. So, but he takes what was given, gives thanks for it, breaks it, gives it back, and then tells them, you give it to the people. I'm an evangelist. My calling is to give the gospel to the world. I cannot give the gospel to the world unless I take myself through this process. Does this make sense to you? You're going to win a sinner boy unless you take yourself through this process. What do? You offer something to God that he can give thanks for. You allow him to break it. And then you allow him to give it back to you. And then when he gives it back to you, you give it to the world. Do you see the distribution process? Do you see the way God involves man in the miracle? This is the way God involves us in his miracles. What's my story? I come from an inner city church. I wasn't always an inner city church. I was in a north end church in Saskatoon for 17 years before we planted City Center Church. And then Pastor Randall and myself came from the staff of that church, and we made City Center our church home. We've been there for 15 years now. And from day one, Reese would tell you, because Reese knows when I was outreach director in that church, he was part of that church in the north end of Saskatoon, always had missions and souls and the nations. It's always been on my heart, always. But I wasn't ready, and I needed to go through this process where you offer what you have. And what do I have? Well, I got some fire in my heart. I don't have any money. I don't have any connections. I don't have a lot of things. But God, I'll offer you this much. And you know when he started to do this transformation that's happened for us in the last 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, Canadian Fire Missions has sort of come onto the map, is from City Center. Sometimes I'll kind of go to God and say, God, you know, City Center hasn't got enough money to send me to Dundurn, you know, like, let alone to the nations. I shouldn't say that because that's not true. But what's true is City Center is a mission unto itself. And see, so as a mission unto itself, the inner city of Saskatoon is our focus. Going into the world is not the focus. Going into the nations of the earth, going to Moldova doesn't count. You know, when you're feeding hungry people every week, it is bona fide a mission unto itself. So God sent me into the missions world from a mission and didn't send me from a church that could afford it to send me anywhere. Like, thinking, God, talk about break you to make you, hey? And so, yeah, many hours spent on my face saying, God, I got this call in my life, and I don't know how I'm ever going to get where I'm supposed to go. How am I going to do this, God? You know what? You offer it to God, he gives it back to you, and then he, you know, what he gives back, it's broken apart, it's torn in pieces, and it's more than what you started with, and you're able to go to the world. And you know, I honestly don't know how it even happens. I honestly don't even know how it happens. But I've got invitations from so many countries around the world. I went to one nation here in May and June. I was in Uganda and Rwanda. I got invited to Democratic Republic of Congo, Burundi, Zambia. I'm going to Kenya and Zambia next month. Where else? Rwanda, Uganda. There was just like this crazy list of countries. And it's like, how? How'd this happen? And, you know, I look at it and I just think, God, but this exact same process. It's the same process. You take the little bit of fire that you have in your heart. You take that little talent or that ability that you have. You offer it to God. He says, thank you to you and to God for what you've offered him. Then he breaks it. What's it feel like for your offering to be broken? What do you think? I'll tell you, it hurts. Painful because you've laid yourself on an altar. You've thrown this out there and the very thing you're passionate about and you're allowed, but you know what? You got to see it from the other side. Jesus is, whatever that quote was that was up here at the start is exactly in line with what I'm saying right now. Is that if he's going to take something out of your life, it's because he's got something better. And so he's breaking, you know, this thing that I thought was so important inside my heart. Why? Because he's setting me up because he wants to do something else. There it is. God's taking it out of your life. It's to make room for something better. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Did you receive something today? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. I want to pray for you today. And I would like to pray for you. And I'd also like to give each of you one of my newsletters, if that's all right with you guys. Is that okay? I don't know where Shelly went. But yeah, just so that you can keep us in mind and most certainly pray for us. I'll tell you, I need your prayers. I end up in some really insane situations. And so I was in Dominican Republic here in January this year. And I wasn't there laying on the beach at Punta Cana. I was in Santo Domingo in some pretty nasty barrios. How many of you have seen any of the side stories when the Olympic Games were in Rio? And you've heard of like a favela? Do you know what a favela is? Anybody? It's just one of those crazy neighborhoods that's just full of drug dealers and houses are built on top of houses on the side of a mountain. So I'm preaching in a church in Dominican, and I notice a guy sitting in the front row on one side, and he's got a gun in his pants right here. So he's got a little pistol right there. And I find out later he's pretty high up in the Dominican military. And then I found out later he drove for the president of the Dominican Republic. So he's a believer, he's a strong Christian, sitting in that church. I'm preaching. He finds out I'm going into one of these nasty neighborhoods the next night. He says, God just spoke to me. I'm coming with you. I thought, okay, cool. He says, I'll drive for you. I thought, okay, cool. So he shows up. Somebody in this church is related to the guy that I was with. Somebody related to Jared. Yeah, to Jared Hanuszewski was with me. And so Jared and I go over into this crazy neighborhood. We don't know how crazy it is, though, but I'm saying all this so that you remember to pray for me, because this is what happened. We jump in his car, and we said, hey, we noticed you carried a gun. He goes, oh, no, you never saw my gun. And I said, yeah, like your gun right here. Oh, no, you never saw my gun. He goes to his truck, and he flips his seat forward in his truck, and he's got a gun. He's got this crazy assault rifle, and then he tells us, I never go into the neighborhood where we're going without this. Oh, really? Where are you taking us? So we go, we preach, you know, it doesn't look so dangerous. You know, I've been in poor neighborhoods before in other countries, and I'm preaching. We're in the middle of Santo Domingo, the capital of the Dominican, and I never thought really much of it. I just thought, okay, we're driving back. It's quite late at night. It was an evening service, and I fell asleep in the front seat of the truck. But what Dominicans might see, less than honorable Dominicans, is they might see the big white dude in the front as a source of, let's rob this gringo right now. And so we have two trucks. I fall asleep on a freeway, kind of like a freeway, a slow freeway, and two trucks pulled up on each side of us and hemmed us in, and a truck in front of us hit the brakes and flipped his hood open. I'm sleeping. I didn't see any of this. Jared saw this. and so he's sitting in the back seat with two Dominicans, and I'm sleeping in the front seat, and a guy comes out of the first truck in front with a machete in his hand coming running towards us. And our buddy with the gun. So I'm thinking, this is how God provides for you. This is why you pray for people who go on missions journeys. He just goes like this with his gun. He just goes, leans on the horn and just goes, beep. And then I woke up when the horn beeped. And he'd already had his gun put away. The guy with the machete jumped back in the truck. Hood went down. Car split apart. And boom, I lived to tell another story. And then a week later, I asked Jared to share something that happened on the trip in our church. And he tells this whole story. And he didn't even tell me all of that. Or if he did, I thought there was a machete involved. And so one of many times and places where, you know, you put yourself into a crazy situation. And yet God has asked you to go there. And he provides. So let me pray for a few of you. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Spirit of the living God. I just come back to the idea of the message involving man in the miraculous, involving a woman in the miraculous, involving children in the miraculous. God wants to use you people. Thank you, Father. I'm so glad that this church released a CD. That's so much in line with the greatness of God. Because the world would say, you can't release a CD from a church in Assiniboia, Saskatchewan. Yeah, you can. Yeah, you can. God can do anything with anyone, anywhere. He's God. He's God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you, you've got some gifts and abilities that are just untapped resources. It's just like, you know, the story that comes to me is the story of Samson. And he's walking over top of something. And the Bible says, he says, I thirst. And then, how does the Bible say it? They tap on the ground or whatever, and they find a spring there. Other people are walking over that ground thirsty so many times, and they call the name of that place En Hakore. I saw it when I was in Israel in April. I saw the sign on the freeway. I thought, hey, I've preached on that. And it was the spring of the caller, or the spring of one calling. That's what it means. And God, has some people that are like that here. You're like that untapped spring. You know, you're like that, you're yet to be discovered. The brother prayed it over the children here just before he released the kids, talking about how kids are like diamonds in the rough. And, you know, how they need to be refined and they need to be have the dirt cleaned off. And they need, but God's doing something, not just with those little ones downstairs, but some people who are hearing my voice right here in this room right now. God. Tap into those things. Could be something as crazy as puppets or cookies. Or crazier yet, I don't know. Maybe I didn't say it. I'm not going to try to be a prophet. I'm an evangelist. So I just want to pray over you guys. Father, thank you for Assiniboia Apostolic Church, Father. I thank you for Pastor Terry and Shelley and, Father, the great leaders that are in this house, the fire that is here. Father God, the people that are called to, Father, to impact this region and beyond, Father God. I thank you, Father. I thank you for big visionaries in this place. Their visions are bigger than the things that are trying to contain them right now, the things that are trying to constrict, the things that are trying to limit them, the lies that say, oh, it's just a Assiniboia. You're just in a small town church. No, those are lies. Those things that constrain and constrict you, I command that those walls be broken down in the name of Jesus Christ. There's some destiny shapers in the room here today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you need your own destiny to be shaped. I don't know if there's anyone here. The guy said earlier that he didn't see any guests. But if there's anyone here, you need to make your life right with Jesus. I want to give you that opportunity right now. Maybe you have served him, you have walked with him, but you've been dabbling in things that you know you shouldn't be. And so I want to give you that opportunity to just make things right with Jesus before we wrap up today. Is there anyone in this room at all? I'm not going to ask you to come forward or, speak in the microphone or anything, but I do want to pray with you. Is there anyone at all? Maybe every head bowed, every eye closed, and I want to make sure everybody has things right with Jesus right now today. Is there anyone in the room at all that says, you know what, that's me, preacher. Please pray for me. Is there anyone? Thank you, Jesus. Anyone at all? I'm just waiting. I don't want to, yeah, thank you, brother. I don't want to make you feel embarrassed. This isn't about embarrassment and shame. This is just about you reconnecting with the Father, reconnecting with Jesus. Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else? You know there's some things you need to deal with on the inside. I could point a couple of you out because I think I know in my own heart where some of you are. And I don't want to do that, though, because I want you to respond. You need to respond to God, not have me respond for you. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Is there anyone? Let's just pray. Thank you, sister. Is there some more? a couple of you. And again, this isn't about shame or embarrassment. This is about making things right with God. Thank you, my friend. You are one of the ones. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Let's make things right. Let's make things right. Great verse in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Where John writes, he says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all our unrighteousness. Thank you, Jesus. So let's go ahead and do that. I know there's different religious groups that make you go do that to a priest, but we have a high priest. And right now you can say, God, I messed up. I'm carrying some baggage I don't need to be carrying. I'm carrying some sin. So let's pray together like this. I'll lead you in a short prayer. I invite you to repeat after me. One part you're going to have to fill in the blanks yourself. But let's pray like this. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus. You sent him so I could be free from sin. So right now I turn from my sin. I ask for your forgiveness. I confess my sin to you. Go ahead and do that. I know you don't, nobody does this really loud, but just tell him, God, forgive me for this. Thank you, Jesus. Let's continue with our prayer. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me. I put my faith and my trust in you. I believe you really do forgive. You forget my sins also. You cast them into a sea of forgetfulness. Help me to forget as well. Help me to walk in newness of life. Help me to walk in the truth that you give me. Be the man or woman of God you called me to be. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. It's funny how you guys just repeat anything. You guys all... Because I'm not preaching no gender craziness here, that you could be the man or woman of God that God called you to be. You be what God made you to be. Amen. Amen. Father, well, thank you for listening today. Could I get one of you guys to help? And I don't know if I have enough of these here, but if somebody could give you each one of these, and I really do covet your prayers. That's your own thing. But if I could get a couple of you guys to just hand those out, and please pray for me. And if God moves on your heart to support us, wonderful. We need your help. If I don't have enough, I might have some more outside in my car. But thank you for being open, receptive hearts. I can tell this is such a well-taught church. Probably enough for couples only. I don't know how many I had there. I don't know if I had enough. But who do I turn this back to? Is there someone? God bless AAC.
Awesome. Awesome. Brad, I want you to stay up here with me for a minute. I do this often with family, and I believe church, this is part of our family. And we want to pray for you. You've prayed for us. You've given us. Who's excited about leaving these doors this morning? I'm excited about going to 121 because I know the guy that you were talking about. And I'm excited about it. Honest, and I'm excited about that the little that I have, God can take that and use that. Yeah. And this is an amazing word. If it wasn't for anybody else, it was for me. Amen. Do you agree with me? That's awesome. So I want you as a family, because I want to treat Brad as a part of our family. I'm going to ask our elders to come, and I want you to come. We're going to pray blessing over. When I started, I said we're going to bless the feet of the one that brings the good news. And so we're going to ask blessing over you, Brad, this morning with you and your wife and your ministry. And come on up. And that's how we're going to close the service. Remember to get your kids after. Don't leave Kimberly down there with them too long. And you guys come on up if you feel like you want to come up. And we're going to surround Brad. And I'm going to ask Monty and...
Father, we give thanks to this messenger. We thank you for your message and the impact that your word has on each one. We pray, Father, that as this man goes and offers that bit that you gave him, that he had for you. Father, we pray that you would multiply that greatly. We thank you that he is obedient. And we pray for obedience too, Lord, in throughout our body. We pray, Father, for your word to multiply. So, Father, we pray your blessing. We pray a blessing from our church as well on this man, that you may go forth and proclaim the gospel, Lord, that the life-giving gospel. We thank you so much for it, Father. So we bless this man. In Jesus' name.
Lord Jesus, I just thank you for a willing vessel, willing servant, someone that is steadfast in his faith and that's serving you well. Lord, the word that I had this morning from the start was, come to us with you who have burdens, come, and I will give you rest. And Lord, I just pray that as Brad has shared this morning about his word being stretched and broken, Lord, that he can rest in you in all that he's venturing out and doing. Lord, that he's laying that down. And Lord, I just pray that you would keep pouring into him as he is faithful and as he's finding rest in you, that we come to you for that. And I ask in the name of Jesus that you, for his family in this season, Lord, of newness and boldness and the direction that you're taking them, that you're going to give them the wisdom to see this through. And Lord, the footprints that you are putting out there for him to follow. Lord, the open doors and the windows of opportunity that you're giving him, we thank you for that. And we know that this, because of that, there's good fruit, and that you are using this vessel for your kingdom and your glory. So, Brad, the word that I have, or that I saw as we're praying, is just of a vessel that leaks, but that's being refilled. And I just pray for that Holy Spirit that you keep refilling over abundantly. Lord, for his wife, for his family, for his kids, for his finances, for his new fresh words that he's getting from you, that it will be with a vessel that's overflowing in the Holy Spirit and all that you have for him. So we just pray together in the name of Jesus for that, a vessel overflowing in your new words that you give for him as he ventures in. And for safety, Lord, as well, we just pray in the name of Jesus for safety, that no harm will come to this man or to his vision that he has for you, that you are ordaining the steps, that you are ordaining every precept on precept, everything that is coming is from you. So I just pray divine safety and wisdom as he goes for it. Lord, we just bind together with him right now as a family and stretch through the miles and keep laying him on our hearts, Lord, as he goes. And just thank you for this special time this morning in Jesus' name. Anyone else?
And Father, I want to pray for his wife and his family and all for those that are more intimately connected with him, that feel his absence in a more personal way, that do have reliance on Brad. Father, I ask that you would be their comforter, fill them with your peace and your love, that Father, you would meet every need that those at home have, that you would bring a solution and support to every situation that would arise. As his wife heads up such a huge and beneficial ministry, we pray, Lord, that you would keep her in health and strength, bring the workers that she needs, and continue to give her connections with those businesses that donate food to their ministry, Lord, that you equip her with everything she needs, and that you would just in a special way keep her and Brad intimate together as they each have such big responsibilities for the kingdom. So Lord, we thank you that you will bless them abundantly, that you are the one that meets all of their needs. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
I just, as we were praying, I just feel like God is just saying, you know, you've said you're just an evangelist, but God wants to increase your gift in the prophetic. I think you need to open your heart and just I mean, you maybe are leaning that way, but I just feel, I really feel like God wants to just open that up.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
May I receive that?
Amen. Anyone else?
Jesus, I pray that the message that Brad prayed here today would get into the hearts of the people of City Center Church, Lord God. Father, I know a lot of them come as needy people, but Father, every one of them has something to give. And so, Father God, I pray that you would help them to understand that principle, Lord God, that we all have something to give and that they would give their broken pieces, Lord God, and allow you to multiply what they have, Lord God. Father, take them, Father, from being victims to who you want them to be, Lord God. Father, we pray that victim mentality would be broken, Lord God. Jesus, Jesus, make them victors in your kingdom, Lord God. Father, the darkness that's been over 20th Street and everyone just accepts, Lord God, that it's a dark area of the city. But Father, that curse be broken. The light is there, Lord God. Father, we pray that your light would increase, Lord God, and it would become a place of glory, Lord God. Your word says your glory will fill the earth. So Father, we pray an increase of your glory over 20th Street in that church, Lord God, over those people, everyone that's been spoken the truth, Lord God. That word be multiplied. Thank you, Jesus.
Awesome. Awesome.
Do you know, it's not just City Center, but God has had me just go into some of the most broken places on earth where people have nothing. And every time you get a chance to go to those places, it makes you come back to Canada and realize, wow, I have some here. And so it just makes you realize, I see pastors in India that just have nothing. Like, they just have nothing. And they're taking on entire villages and cities, and they're just doing so much with so little. So this principle I'm talking about, I've seen it played out firsthand. It's real. That God can take the little bit that we got and he can do something with it. And so I encourage you to take what you have. We have so much in Canada. And thank you for thinking of my wife and my family. People don't think of that side of a missionary or evangelist life, is that sometimes we're away from family and home for long times, and that hurts. You don't even know the feeling of that unless you've walked through it, to be 10,000 miles from your spouse that you love. And so thank you for thinking of that. God bless you all.